Today is Saturday, October 20th. I am Derek Hay, and I own the adult talent agency LA Direct Models. We are in Las Vegas, where I reside. We're here today to answer some questions, put some facts on the record. There is a producer whose name I will mispronounce wonderfully, I'm sure, throughout this interview. To the best of my knowledge, his name is Dan Prizigoda, who claims to work for a station affiliated with NBC, who has for approximately a year been asking questions of persons in our industry, many of whom are model clients of my own agency, some of whom are model clients of other agencies, asking questions about myself, my staff, how we conduct our business, what policies we adopt or don't adopt, and so forth. I actually called Mr. Prizigoda about 4 months ago. I obtained his number from a girl who had no interest in speaking with him. He was, of course, surprised to get my call and told me that he wasn't able to speak to me. Then on September 6th, 2018, I received an email from him telling me that he was investigating a story or writing a story related to the case recently filed by an attorney of the name of Alan Gobard, citing the plaintiffs as Jane Doe 1, 2, 3, and 4. Through the administrative hearing of the Department of Labor, i.e. the Labor Commissioner in California, and would I agree to an on-camera interview about that? I told him that I would, but set forth certain parameters to that, which included limiting his questions to that case such that I was able to answer questions in the case without jeopardizing the case itself, that he would be the only one asking me questions, he'd be the only interviewer, that there wouldn't be an audience, that only himself and necessary production staff would be present. Also, that the interview would be limited to 30 minutes. He wrote back and declined that, said that he couldn't accept those terms for the interview, but he still wanted to conduct an on-camera interview, obviously. He wanted to conduct it on his own terms and not mine. So we didn't do the interview. What he then did was sent a certified letter to my own home and also to the home of one of my accountants with a whole list of questions entirely unrelated to the Labor Commissioner case, which is actually what I suspected all along, because when I wrote back to him after receiving his email on September 6th and him stating that was writing a story on the Jane Doe case, my first line back to him was, that's a change of tack then, because you spent many months already asking questions about anything except that case. Of course, that case didn't even exist until early July, so he'd spent at least 6-7 months asking questions on anything except that. And so, in any case, in the certified letters that my accountant and I myself received at our personal residences, list a number of questions, none of which are related to the Jane Doe case. So, since I'm not agreeable to do an on-camera interview with him, I am happy to answer those questions, or at least most of those questions, on camera, where the answers can't be edited to mean something else. So that's the reason that we're here today, so that anybody who views this can view it under the knowing is the reason that I'm doing this today.
Now, one moment to the form of his approach to you. You've been a subject of media interest for many years. Have you ever experienced someone sending a certified letter to you with questions, or to your residence, or to an employee's residence? Is this uncommon? It seems uncommon to me.
Certainly it's uncommon. I've never heard of it happening before. It's never happened to me before. To speak to the longevity of how long we've been in business, we're in the 19th year of being in business.
So among the questions that he asks are things along the lines of whether or not you have ever pressured the models with whom you work into performing sexual favors, either in abatance of debt or for any other reason? And I guess that would be my first question.
That is his first question, yes. The answer to that is no.
Have you ever sexually abused one of your clients? A similar but distinct question I wanted to have you give a direct answer to.
The direct answer is no. And obviously the question itself is offensive in nature.
Yeah. Similarly, another question, have you ever attempted to do the same? And I'll let you answer that.
And again, the answer is no. And again, I find the question offensive.
Now, there are several questions regarding the operations of the business, which go to just the basic functions of what an agent does and how an agent is paid and how the performers are paid. And one of the questions is whether or not you charge a fee to producers or directors to book your models on their shoots. And how does that work? What is the answer? How does that work?
Yes, we do charge a fee, yes. It's called a booking fee or an agency fee. And it's universal, the practice of doing so is universal in the adult film industry as well as mainstream television or feature film. We've in fact booked our clients to mainstream television and feature film numerous occasions. The common practice in what we refer to in the adult business as mainstream, meaning regular television and feature film, is plus 10%. So the agent will negotiate the fee of the artist and then add on 10% as their fee to the film studio, to the employer. The agent is usually will charge the artist whatever the commission rate is agreed between the agent and the artist. So they're getting plus 10% from in mainstream from the employer and the commission that they're charging their artist. In adult film, we usually do not charge plus 10%. It's usually a flat fee, which is typically $100. And then we get either our agency commission, which is almost always either 10 or 15% from our artist.
I'll jump around a little bit to continue on the business thing. Have you ever charged a client a kill fee, and one that was not requested by the producer or production company? It's an odd form of a question, but can you explain what a kill fee is and why it would be charged ever?
A kill fee is a fee charged by one party to another because of the harm caused to the former by the latter cancelling on short notice. Our own policy is that kill fees can only be charged or paid if the cancellation is same day. But we define same day as anything after 6 p.m. the evening prior to the shoot or the employment.
At the end of business the previous day?
Yes. So if a model is employed on a Wednesday, anything after 6 p.m. on Tuesday would constitute the same day of the Wednesday. So anything that came after 6 p.m., whether it was Tuesday evening or Wednesday morning, if the model said, I'm not going to my shoot, the producer, the employer, the studio can charge the model a kill fee. If the studio says, whatever they say, we're canceling the model for today's shoot, then they will be charged a kill fee which the model will receive. So that's the definition of a kill fee. There's another terminology used which is essentially the same thing, but production damage fee. I mean, that's used, you know, when a model cancels on a film studio, then the term production damage fee, it's obvious what that means. You've caused damage to the production, they're going to charge you a fee, which is a standardized fee in most cases of $200 in our industry. It's a standardized fee.
Does your agency charge your clients additional fees for using dryers?
Not additional fees, no. We agree with all of our models that their commission rate will be 15% if they use our driver and 10% if they don't. So they know if they choose to use our driver, we're going to commission 15, and if they don't use our driver, i.e. they take themselves to their employment, the commission rate will be 10. So there's a difference of 5% there, but there's no additional fee for the driver, which I know some agencies charge 15% plus $50 for a driver. So my understanding of the question is, do you add anything on to the commission percentage? And the answer is no.
How about a fee for being late to set?
Would you like to read that question?
Yes, yes. It says, does your agency charge your clients additional fees for using drivers or being late to set?
The agency does not charge a model any fee for being late to set, but many of the film studios do. It's very common to get shoot information, and on it will be listed what penalty the model will incur if she's late to, or he, I shouldn't say she, if they are late to set, because it's he or she, could be male or female model, so I shouldn't say she. But typically, and almost universally accepted, the film studios will deduct $50 for each 30 minutes that a model is late. And some of them will cancel the model completely and charge a kill fee if they're late more than 1 hour.
Now, the letters that I've seen from this producer display a fascination with the escorting business, the world of escorting. And there are several questions regarding whether or not you have referred performers to escorting. The implication seems to be that someone signs with you and they somehow end up escorting. So do you want to address the truth or falsity of that and how it actually works in the real world?
We have no need to refer our model, excuse me for smiling, but I mean, it's slightly comical in nature. We have no need to refer our models to escort agencies. I would say, without question, the majority of female adult film models and a number of male adult film models work as escorts. By rough approximation, and my estimation would be an informed one, I've never, made a study or whatever, but, if I was asked to guess, I would say it was somewhere between 60 and 70% of female models work as escorts. I suppose it isn't, additionally to their film work, I suppose it isn't a great leap of understanding needed to think if a model is comfortable, naked, having sex in front of a camera for all the world later to see, that she might be comfortable doing the same, not in front of a camera, for reasonably high rates of pay. In some cases, much higher rates of pay than the adult film industry offers her. So, is a new model coming into this business likely to hear about those sort of avenues of work from other models that she meets in the first few months of the business? Yes, she's very likely to hear about that and find her way or find the phone numbers of whichever company or companies she might choose to pursue that line of work with.
There are several questions in the letters that I've seen from this producer that reference a particular escort agency called the Luxury Companion, and wanting to know specifically if you've ever referred your clients to them.
Specifically, no. We do not refer models to that escort agency or any other escort agency. We don't necessarily encourage that work. Well, not don't necessarily. We don't suggest it to any of the models. As I previously explained, the models will quickly learn about that from other models and decide if they want to do that or not to do it. It really has nothing to do with direct models. We don't book escort work. We're not referring to escort agencies. At the same time, I believe one of the other questions here was, do I know the owner of that agency? And certainly I do know the owner of that agency.
It would seem to me that in terms of that your business relies upon the availability of models, it might actually be a disincentive for you to have someone being available, being working on other types of work. It may make it more difficult for you to book them because there's some girls who will go on tour, for instance. So is that something that's that is an issue in your field?
If I may, the viewer might need to know what going on tour means.
Yeah, please.
Would you like to?
Well, on tour for escorting. One day I'll say I'll be in New York.
I understand what the terminology means, but I wonder if the viewer understands.
Yes.
I will explain so there's no... I understand what it means. Going on tour means can mean they travel to a city for a week, 2 weeks, a period of time, and make themselves available for that work. Sometimes it can literally mean a tour where they're in one city for a week and a different city for another week, or whatever. They're traveling to do that work. Going on tour is rarely any issue for us because the model will say to us, in a month's time, I want these 2 weeks off. They're not necessarily telling us why they want it off, and that's okay. We don't need to know, but I want 2 weeks off. Fine, take 2 weeks off. We know they're not available. We don't book them, and off they go. What sometimes is a problem for us is more short-term and immediate offers that they receive, which can, I mentioned earlier, the earnings in that field can be much higher than in regular adult film, and the work easier, obviously. So on occasion, there can be a conflict because we could have had work employment booked with a adult film studio for a week or several weeks on the calendar, and an offer has been received by our model client to do something else in that arena, which she's more inclined to do because the earning from that is much higher. And let's face it, the work demanded of her is easier. Not forgetting that, on average, to go and shoot for an adult film studio, the average is about 6 hours for a female model, but it could be as long as 10 or 12 hours.
Now, along the lines of the escorting thing, there are questions about, are you familiar with the term booking a client for a private? Meaning, the term being a private, which I assume means a private engagement of some sort, and what would that mean to you?
I am familiar with that term, yeah. The word private is used to describe booking a model, whether she's an adult film actress or not, for an appointment with a client in the escort arena. That's what private means. So booking a private, that's what it means.
And this producer asks specifically if your agency ever books your clients for privates.
No, we don't book privates because we don't book escort work. We're not an escort agency. We're a licensed and bonded talent agency, and we book our clients for work in the adult film industry and other related things. I mean, we're not limited to the adult film industry, and I mentioned before, we do book some television and, Hollywood feature film work. That's not our meat and potatoes. Our meat and potatoes is the adult film industry and many sort of things related to that, which include hosting nightclubs, appearances at adult film stores, at adult bookstores and so on, adult stores in general. All manner of things, but, the meat and potatoes of it is the adult film industry.
Now, another couple of questions refer to property that you own, that you may be renting to clients as a place to live. That's the phrase. Do you want to address that?
I'm not prepared to talk about where our models live. That I received a certified letter to my own residence, that a certified letter was sent to my accountant's residence is intrusive. I think even in the mafia, right? I think there's certain lines that shouldn't be crossed. You know, it's you want to do investigative journalism about me or my business or something. Okay, you come knock on my office door or send me emails to my work email. You start intruding into my home and the home of my staff, like that's a completely different matter. I think that's really out of bounds. And I'm certainly not about to answer questions about where our model clients live or don't live. It's obvious at certain points, you know, through the 19 years we've been in business, some girls have had issues with stalkers. You know, some cases they have definitely have overzealous fans. I'm prepared to answer questions about where those models live.
Now, there's a question that's ancillary to that, asking if whether you've ever had a driver take someone out and drive them out into the middle of nowhere. It's not a question. What do you think
It's not that odd a question, actually. I think I should make plain at this point that, you know, we're well aware that Mr. Dan Prisigoda is working with two girls at least, one of which is Lisa Ann, of course, the well-known adult film actress, who's held a grudge against my company, or me and my company, for a long time, despite the fact that I'm not sure which retirement it was that she came out of, I think in 2007. I think she'd already retired twice by then and now has retired four times. But anyway, I digress. My company hired her in 2007. She came out of retirement not wanting to shoot anymore, apparently, and we offered her a job as a agent, which actually she did quite well for about a year and then decided she did want to shoot again and went off to shoot again. And later, of course, formed her own agency. But, you know, at various times in the last few years, you know, we've endured Twitter tirades from Miss Anne, which in the past have also included wild allegations of having driven models to deserted desert highways. And that's not the lyric of a song. That's one of her Twitter tirades. So we recognize the idiocy of that sort of question immediately. So thank you, Lisa, for that question. And
there's another one there, too, asking whether or not you've ever had someone's belongings packed up, boxed up while they're staying at this house, or a house. A strange question, but I mean, is that another Lisa Ann type question?
That without question, without doubt, is another Lisa Ann question, yes. Yeah. I'm unaware of anyone ever having claimed that we did them wrong by boxing up their belongings and mailing them back to them.
Now, another question is, does your agency request that the clients have their checks sent to the LA Direct offices, and if so, why?
Does the agency request, can you repeat that question? Does the agency request
that clients have their paychecks, presumably their checks from performances,
right,
sent to the LA Direct offices, and if so, why?
Yes, in a manner of speaking, yes. In the adult industry, approximately 50% of studios pay the models the same day, which is universally called same-day pay, obviously. Which means that 50% of studios do not pay same-day pay. So then, how do the models get paid if they're not paid same day? A variety of methods, but most of the time, either their check will arrive at the agency's office and be given to them, or the employer pays the agency and we then pay the model. again, talking about mainstream in television and feature film, the common practice, the universal common practice, is that the employer, the studio, pays the agent, always pays the agent. The agent removes the agency commission from the artist's earnings and forwards the balance to their artist client. That happens with us too, about 20% of the time. So otherwise, if it's not that, we usually take the lead in ensuring that our artists get paid and the collection of the checks, but then the checks are not mailed. We actually prohibit mailing checks. We have a strict rule that no checks are to go in the mail. Why do you have that rule? Well, A, the postal service is pretty unreliable, so probably if you put 10 checks in the mail, one of them won't show up. Also, you know, as everybody knows, it's the oldest excuse ever, right? You know, your check's in the mail and I promise I won't come in your mailbox, right? That's why we prohibit any checks in the mail, okay? We're not interested in, I put it in the mail yesterday, I'll put it in the mail Monday, da da da. So if checks are owing to our clients, we tell those companies, let us know when the checks are ready, leave them in your front office and our driver will come and pick them up. That way we know they're either there or they're not there. When they're there, they arrive back at our office. Our accounting staff will let our model clients know your check for this particular shoot is here.
Now, do you encourage your clients to use your business address? And would that be for similar reasons as you not want to discuss their where they live and all that? Is that a privacy thing?
We absolutely do. We absolutely do. Every time a model goes to a shoot, they have to complete what's called a model release, which gives the employer, the studio, the company for which they're working that day, all the rights to the material that they're going to create that day. The model owns none of it, and the company owns all of it. They have to complete a model release agreeing to that. And on that model release, as you can imagine, it's always the model's real name, stage name, date of birth, social security number, and also their address. And we encourage them to use our office address and our office email and phone number. Sometimes those model releases get into the hands of people that they shouldn't. And all, not just some personal information, but if they've literally put their home address on there and their real phone number, then that person now knows everything they needed to know about whomever that is. So yes, we do encourage them to use our office address.
Now, there's another question, which I'll say, is it reads odd to me. Have you ever, or anyone at your agency, ordered any of your drivers to have your clients sign over the checks to the company if they're paid on set? Meaning, do you have your driver somehow convince or encourage the performer to sign over? Sugar? I know, I see people looking crazy. It seems ludicrous, but I have to ask that question.
This is another kind of comical question. I have to say,
it's like a strong-arming question. Are your drivers saying, "Hey, you better sign your check over to your agent"? I mean, is that
what they mean by company?
I don't know. Is it? I presume that's what it means to the company. Yes, yeah. To your company.
To my company, not the company for whom they work.
I assume that's what it means. Have them sign over the checks. I guess it would mean to your company. Well, why would they sign back over to the person who just paid them? And I mean, not that that makes any more sense, but...
It's difficult to understand the question, actually. And if Mr. Prisigoda has been researching this for a year, you might reasonably think that he could format the questions in a way at least they could be understood. The answer is, obviously the answer is no. I mean, first of all, our drivers drive. They're not involved in accounting at all. So all our drivers are ever concerned with is, I pick someone up from here and I take them there. And then later in the day, I pick them up from there and I take them back where I picked them up in the first place. So drivers drive and accountants do accounting. So our drivers are never involved in anything to do with accounting or checks.
Now, Now, there are some other accounting questions. Have you or anyone at your agency directed your accountants, and I won't give her name, to cash checks received for your clients at a check cashing store or anywhere? And if so, why? Is it, do you have the, I guess the first question I would ask to make it more clear is, do you have the, by contract, the power to cash a check for a client, and how do you use that authority, if you have
it? We do have that authority. The licensed talent agents have the authority to handle the finances of their clients, enshrined in the Talent Agency Act of 1978, in much the same way that attorneys do. You know, if you slip over in a supermarket because they left a wet puddle on the floor, and you get an attorney to sue the supermarket for their negligence in having a wet floor that caused you an injury, and you win, then the supermarket, or at least the supermarket's insurance company, pays the attorney. They don't pay you directly, they pay the attorney. The attorney then says, you owe me 30% of that, and here's 70%. Well, we maintain a client trust account in exactly the same way. So when we receive funds that are the funds of our clients and not ours, or at least funds which are a mix, some of it may be ours and other of it our clients, those funds will go into the trust account and be dispersed out of it. So, you know, if Model A has earned $1,000 and we receive $1,000, but she owes us 10%, well, it will go into the client trust account. From that client trust account, the model will be paid $900 and the agency will receive $100, 90% and 10%. So sometimes we receive, as I mentioned earlier, we receive gross amounts of money from employers, goes in there and disperse. At other times we may receive a check for a particular client, and we will deposit and disperse, or cash the check and disperse, the same thing.
Another financial question in this letter, asking whether the agency charges producers, directors, or production companies for testing fees. I'll assume that means HIV and STI testing. Would you want to tell me how that system works, who gets paid, and how it operates?
Certainly, yes. And the answer is yes, but not always. Since approximately 1997, I think, the adult industry has required testing, for obvious reason, sexually transmitted disease testing, which as the years have progressed since that time, the testing has become, the panel of tests has become better and better, more rigid, more tests, better tests, so on. And up until September of 2013, it was the testing, the regularity of the testing was once a month, once every 30 days. In September of 2013, a lady called Diane Duke, who at the time was the head of the Free Speech Coalition, unilaterally decided, without any consultation with any adult film studios, with any agents, with any models, just solely her, and with no, as I said, no consultation at all, that the regularity of that testing should change from every 30 days to every 14 days. Models, although it's actually against the law, models pay for their own tests. I say against the law because if you read the law in California, or, and I haven't studied it in other states to be honest, but I'm certain it would be the same. The employer should be paying for any medical test or vaccination, etc., any sort of health screening that's necessary prior to the employment taking place. In the adult industry, it has never been the case. The model pays for her own test. So when Diane Duke proclaimed in September 2013 to change that, that meant doubling the cost of testing for each model each month, because if you're going to test twice a month, then it costs twice as much as it would to test once a month. Direct Models decided that the companies that employ these models, if they wanted a test, a 14-day test, meaning a test that's taken twice a month, and therefore burdening the models with double the cost of testing each month from that had gone before, that they should at least contribute or share in some of that additional cost. So we implemented a policy that said any company that wants a 14-day test will pay the model $20 for each day that they employ the model.
Above and beyond their fee.
Above and beyond their fee. It's like a 14-day medical test stipend, if you like. If you employ this model and you want the twice a month testing, you pay them $20 towards the additional cost that testing is above the industry norm.
Okay. And how is that administered? That is separate from their check?
It is separate from their check. It's not in their check at all. So that's administrated we spoke earlier about the agency booking fee. When we invoice for that agency booking fee, if we're invoicing a company that's employed our model and has a 14-day test policy, then we'll invoice our agency booking fee plus $20. And on our model's statement, which they have a running statement on which everything they do, every shoot they do, every charge made, any royalties received, etc., every financial thing that happens is on that statement every time it occurs, they will get a credit of $20 on that day. So if Jane Smith works on May 1st for adult film studio ABC and she makes $1,000 and they require a 14-day test, on her statement from us, will show on May 1st you worked for ABC Adult Film Studio, you made $1,000, Direct Models is charging you 10%, so you owe Direct Models $100, but it was a 14-day company, so we charged them $20 towards your test, so minus $20, now you owe $80. So that's how they receive that $20.
Okay. The benefit of that is that they don't pay, it's not gross income for tax purposes. It's a reimbursement.
Oh, 100% it's a reimbursement. And that's a very good point, because some companies for a little while struggled to get their head around that, saying, well, why can't I just add it onto the model's check? Which, it's not income. It's exactly as you say, it's reimbursement. So it's not taxable income. If you added it on their check, then they would ostensibly receive 30% less, right? So they would receive $14, not $20. So, and the government would receive $7 that isn't owed to them.
Now, one thing you mentioned is that you said you now owe $80. I think perhaps you should explain that the model owes the fee that very often there's a ledger. Or sometimes there's a running balance of fees owed, and how often is it that the agency is owed money on a continual basis from the models?
Continuously, almost universally. Most models, most of the time, owe the agency money.
See, that's in common too. People would think you're making all this money and that you're paying the models, but in fact, half the time they're getting paid directly.
Right.
And so they owe you a fee out of that or from any other.
Exactly. So, if you step up to the roulette table, the ball can fall in red 7 times in a row, right? 10 times in a row even, right? You can't predict whether it's going to come out red or black. If you could, you'd be rich, right? So even though 50% of the time is same day pay, 50% of the time it's not. That doesn't mean that it's one day one thing and the next the other and then back to the first. A model could go to work and do 5, 6, 7 shoots in a row and they're all same day pay. So, especially if a model is genuinely busy and doesn't have much time off, the model's got 5, 6, 7 checks in their pocket. We've received none of those funds, so we're asking the model, please come in and pay us our agency commission for the work we did in procuring that employment for you.
Right, but if any of those were 14-day test scenes, then you will receive the $20 that you can take off of their debt.
Well, yes, but in theory, yes. But I mean, that's true. But, you know, on average, if an average day's earning of a model is, of a female model anyway, is $1,000, let's say, it could be way less and it could be way more. But just as a reasonable average, let's say, and they're not paying less than 10% and they could be paying 15%, so they're either paying 100 or they owe 100 or 150, $20 isn't making much difference. But anyway, with absolute certainty, they're always receiving that $20.
Along to the overseas clients, had the agency ever signed a client from overseas and then set them up for work in the U.S. without a working visa? I guess it means proper paperwork so that they're able to legally work in the U.S.
We've actually sponsored work permits for models many times. We are not, of course, the employer, so we're not employing. An agency doesn't employ models. An agency procures employment on behalf of the model, and whichever studio, whichever film company chooses to hire the model is employing the model. So as an agency, we're not employing the model anyway. But we are able to sponsor models which for work visas, which we have done many times, and always under the O-1 visa program, which is person of extraordinary ability, which people think it's amusing to think that an adult film actress can be a person of extraordinary ability. Of course, the opportunity for humor there is rich, but it matters not what the field of endeavor is, whether you're a computer programmer, an athlete, the world's most famous barista, you know.
Or a rock star, I imagine people on tour have to do the same thing.
Absolutely. A world famous musician, or not, don't have to even be that famous, but you are, you know, if you are exceptional in your particular field of endeavor, then O-1 visas are available if you can prove your case satisfactorily.
And in these instances, they have, and you sponsor them, and they get to come here.
That's correct.
The last question that he directs to you is, have you ever refused to let someone out of their contract after they've requested it to be let out?
Oh, yes, definitely. Yeah, absolutely. I love the inference in the question that because we haven't let them out when they've asked, that we acted inappropriately. You can feel the inference that that's incorrect. I would love to. I'm not a big fan of American sport necessarily, but I'd love to see, you know, the face on the manager of the LA Lakers who said, "Oh, Kobe Bryant wants to leave. Have you let him out of the contract?" Well, no, of course we haven't. We've invested tens of millions of dollars in him, and if we're gonna let him out of his contract to whomever, then we want to be paid. Well, it's not necessarily quite like that in our business, but you know, if we sign a model and guide them to success, we certainly want to continue to participate in that success, at least until the end of the agreement that we made with them in the first place, whatever term that is, which is most commonly probably 3 years, but the state of California prohibits us for signing a model in excess of 7 years, although we never have signed a model, not a female model anyway, for as long as that. But so the answer is yes. I mean, definitely. Much like in sports or any other business, if you have a contractual relationship with an artist, with a client, with an employee, you have a contract with them, you don't let them out just because you're asked to. You may negotiate the terms of an early release. Again, another similarity would be if you're a resident in a building and you have a lease and you decide you want to leave early and you ask the landlord, can I just leave? I think invariably the answer is no.
Yeah. Now, this leads me to recall at least one case from years ago where the attorney, Mr. Gelbart, represented a couple of clients of LA Direct who wanted out of their contract. And you want to speak to that case and how that turned out?
You're referring to the Star Sisters?
Yes.
Yes, Mr. Gelbart, he did, yeah. That, I can't remember which way round it was because obviously he's the attorney in the Jane Doe case, which is the third go around with him. He's had two goes at us previously. He lost both times. So, yeah, we understand that this is a personal thing with Mr. Gelbart and me, or me and my company anyway. But anyway, in the Star Sister case, there are two sisters, the Star Sisters, who he represented, threatened all kinds of things, all kinds of criminal conduct that I was guilty of, that he was going to whistleblow to various law enforcement agencies and so forth if we didn't let him out. We actually let one of the sisters out because at the time she was with a controlling and abusive partner, we felt, difficult to manage. So we did let her out, and we didn't let the other one out. The upshot of that case was we agreed a buyout where the other sister paid us to terminate our artist agency agreement with her, and she left.
And now there have been accusations made by the sisters about, you know, basically saying bad things about you and about the agency publicly in social media. Yet the sister who did the buyout ended up back with your agency.
Yeah, I know. It's a supreme irony. Yeah. So,
Do you think that was a leveraging tactic?
What, to use social media in an abusive way?
Yes.
Well, yeah, obviously, yeah. But the truth, and I mean, not only did the younger sister come back to us a couple of years later, but the other sister came back to us as well and said, will you take me back as well? Which we didn't, although I own another agency called the Lee Network, which we book adult stars for feature dancing, and that agency did accept the older sister back as well because those two sisters like to perform as a duo act, as a sister act, which is obviously very marketable. So we did let her come back so that we could book her for feature dancing, but not for adult movies. But yeah, I mean, if we had said yes, then both sisters would have been back.
I missed one question. Actually, we'll take this as the best for last. Has the agency ever directed talent recruits or paid people but brought in girls looking to enter the adult industry to scout for talent in shopping malls near schools? In other words, are you hiring or encouraging predators to go to shopping centers and pick up teeny boppers to enter the adult industry?
Right. Okay. Well, no. Obviously, we actually don't really have any talent scouts. There are people who from time to time refer models to us, but they're not, we don't have any scouts that we employ. You know, if there's a reasonable, because Direct Models has been in business 19 years and it's very well known, so there's a reasonable chance that any girl anywhere, if she says to somebody, oh, I'm thinking of getting in adult film, and that person either knows us or knows of us, because we know a lot of people, there's a pretty good chance that somebody will say, you should get in touch with Direct Models. We're easy to find. For the most part, models find us. We're not scouting for models. We're not on Facebook, cam sites, sexy jobs. We're not really looking for models. For the most part, models come to us.